ఇంటర్మీడియట్ విద్యా రంగంలో అగ్రగామి మన ఎన్ఎస్ఆర్ ఇంపల్స్ ఎడ్యుకేషన్ ఇన్స్టిట్యూషన్ ఐఐటి జేఈఈ అయినా నీట్ అయినా తిరుగులేని విద్యా సంస్థ ఎన్ఎస్ఆర్ ఇంపల్స్
నౌ సో ఎల్ఏఓ వి హావ్ డిస్కస్డ్ అబౌట్ ద మోడిఫికేషన్స్ వాట్ ఆర్ ద థింగ్స్ వి స్టడీడ్ అబౌట్ రూట్ వి స్టడీడ్ అండ్ వి స్టడీడ్ అబౌట్ రూట్ మోడిఫికేషన్స్ And earlier we have clear picture of all the types of root modifications along with the examples. Similarly, we studied about stem modifications. So far we have discussed what is root, what are the functions of the root, what is root zonation, types of root, and we studied about root modifications. All are important. Similarly, what is a stem? And what are the functions of the stem? Similarly, we discussed about all three types of stem modifications. What are they? Underground stem modifications, subaerial stem modifications, and aerial stem modifications. Now, let us go with what is called leaf. Let us study about what we call leaf. So, I already have given little basics about the leaf. Now, let us see very clearly about the complete leaf part. Okay. So here. Generally, if you take the leaf part, so the place where there is a formation itself is called as axillary bud, or we call this as what? A lateral bud. The place where there is an origin of leaf formation, it's nothing but what? Axillary bud or lateral bud. And the place itself from where leaf produced itself is called node. We know it very well. The place where there is a formation of leaf, it's called node, right? So here if you look at the very early formation here, the leaf has the stalk. The stalk of the leaf itself is called petiole. What is petiole? It's called leaf stalk. It's called leaf stalk. What is petiole? Simply in your garden or in your surroundings, you take the leaf and see that leaf has a stalk. The stalk of the leaf itself is called petiole. Remember, it's called petiole. What is petiole? Leaf stalk, right? But here, after formation of the petiole and the leaf here, from the axillary bud, on either side of axillary bud are two small leaf-like structures you can see. They are called stipules. I'll write here. They are called stipules. So how we can refer stipules, how we can define stipules? Stipules are nothing but a small leaf like structures, or small leaf like structures arises on either side of petiole. Okay, how do you define stipules? I repeat again, a small leaf like structures arises on either side of petiole. So this is the petiole, this is the petiole. On either side of petiole you can see a small leaf like structures, very small and tiny leaf like structures, which we call them as stipules. Generally you can take any leaf, observe that from the base of the petiole, it's very small, tiny, sensitive, very smooth ones, which are called as what? Stipules. Now let us come to the petiole. Petiole here, it makes, what are the functions of petiole? It exposes leaf surface to sunlight. It exposes leaf surface to sunlight. So you know, whenever this is stalk, this is a leaf. Leaf, it makes a petiole, will make the leaf to get exposed to the sunlight. So the leaf lamina surface, the surface is called leaf lamina, makes the leaf lamina to get exposed to the sunlight. So apart from this, it flutters the leaf to reduce temperature. Itself is called cooling phenomena, where it reduces up to 10 to 15 degrees centigrade. Cooling means it decreases. I repeat again, nothing, simply flutters leaf to reduce temperature. So leaf is like this. Imagine this is a leaf, this is a petiole. What petiole will make? It will make the leaf to flutter to all directions, to the direction of wind blowing. If wind blowing this direction, it blows this side. If wind blows this direction, blows this side. As when keep flutters itself, it surrounding the leaf, temperature reduces. It causes cooling of leaf surface, decreases, aromatic down means decreases. Decreases 10 to 15 degrees centigrade of temperature. Okay, it causes cooling. Cooling how? By decreasing 10 to 15 degrees temperature. See, such a vigorous movement of the leaf can reduce the temperature up to 10 to 15 degrees. See, and it can cause cooling. So flutters leaf to reduce temperature. Right. Now, if you see in some cases, so here you find that the leaf base, what you can see here, it's nothing but leaf base. Right, leaf base contains what? Axillary bud or lateral bud? Leaf base contains what? Stipule. Sometimes you'll get the question that leaf base contains. Remember two things. One is axillary bud or lateral bud, obviously. And from the leaf base, what comes are nothing but stipules. So that is nothing but leaf base. Base is nothing but origin, from where there's a formation of petiole. Petiole into leaf. Right. Now let us come to the leaf part. So here altogether, if you look at, this is what you call leaf margin. So here you can draw like this also. So this is what is called leaf margin. The surface area, it's called leaf margin. The border is called leaf margin. Then this is leaf lamina. Leaf lamina itself is called leaf surface. Leaf lamina itself is called leaf surface. Now, in the center you find midrib, or itself is called midween. Okay, now we are studying the different parts of the leaf. The boundary, what you find here, it's called leaf margin. The surface area, what you find, is called leaf lamina, or it's called leaf surface. Centermost thick region, it's called midrib or midrib. Earlier also we discussed, right? Then what it contains, you know that it contains vascular bundles. What vascular bundle contain? So here you find xylem, and you find what is called phloem. So here xylem is the one which supply water, phloem is the one which supply food. So I write here, midvein contains what? Vascular tissues, vascular bundles. What are they? They are two, xylem and phloem. So we already have the clarity here. What is the function of the xylem? Xylem conducts water. Xylem conducts water. Phloem conducts food material. I hope up to here it's very clear. Earlier also we discussed xylem vascular bundles. This is called vascular bundle. Each one is called vascular bundle. Take the midrib of the leaf. You may be thinking that leaf, in that leaf midrib is thick somewhat, but it's so small. But in that so small thing, if you take the midrib from the leaf, if you put it under the microscope, so many components of xylem, so many components of phloem is present. Xylem means not one simple compound. Xylem has four compounds. Phloem also has four compounds. What are they? We'll discuss later. But if you cut the midrib and if you observe under microscope, clearly you can see what are called vascular bundles. This is how vascular bundles are arranged. So what are these vascular bundles contain? Xylem and phloem. Xylem conducts water and phloem conducts food. Right. Now, how do they distribute to the total leaf surface area? So here you find what are called as veins. So you studied already, they contain what are called as veins. Veins contain smaller ones called veinlets. So here these are veins and here you find what are called veinlets. Through veins and veinlets here, the food and water get circulated across the leaf lamina. So here if you take the leaf lamina or the leaf surface, what it contains? Leaf lamina or leaf surface contains cells. What cells? You know, in lower classes you studied, it contains mesophyll cells. Okay, what it contain? Better I'll write down. What does that leaf surface contain? Mesophyll cells. Leaf surface contain what are called? Mesophyll cells. So this is nothing but the complete structure of the leaf. Right, I repeat again. So here the place where leaf arises is called leaf base. The bud is called axillary or lateral bud. A small leaf like structures arises on either side of the petiole are called stipules. Then the stalk, it's called petiole. What are the functions of the petiole? Exposes leaf surface to the sunlight and flutters the leaf to reduce temperature, means causes cooling effect, decreases the temperature up to 10 to 15 degrees centigrade. Who does the function? Petiole, right? And leaf has a margin, it's called leaf margin, and here leaf surface area, it's called leaf lamina. In leaf lamina you find what are called mesophyll cells. Mesophyll cells contain what? Chloroplast, right? So when they contain chloroplast, it's involved in photosynthesis. You know, leaves are the ones which undergo photosynthesis. One second. Right. So here in the leaf lamina or leaf surface, in lower classes you studied, it contain mesophyll. Mesophyll contain chloroplast, and leaves are the very important source called photosynthesis. Leaves are the source of undergoing photosynthesis. They involve in the preparation of food material, preparation of food. The food, what is produced here? It's stored in the form of starch or sucrose. Yes or no? So the preparation of the food takes place in the leaves by the process called photosynthesis, and the food is stored, a stored starch or sucrose. The food gets stored in the form of starch or sucrose, right? And you know that here it contains midvein or midrib, it contains vascular bundles, xylem and phloem. Xylem conducts water, phloem conducts food here, and that food and water circulated to entire leaf, to all the cells through veins and veinlets. So this is nothing but what we say, this is nothing but a structure of leaf. What we have discussed, this is nothing but what? A structure of leaf. Right. Now, so if you take the functions, we studied one of the function is, what are the functions of leaf we can write? Just now we have written photosynthesis. Right. And also involved in conduction of food, and also provides mechanical support. In some of the plants, leaves also provides mechanical support, and even leaves contain stomata. They also undergo what is called transpiration. You know, on the surface of the leaves, here and there, what you find in lower classes, you might have studied. If not, we'll study in further classes. You can see stomata. On the surface of the leaf, you can see a small opening. This is called as what? Stomata. Stomata is the one which loses small water droplets, and loss of water itself is called transpiration. Loss of water itself is called transpiration. Loss of water from where to where? Loss of water from the leaf surface to atmosphere. Then it's called as what? Transpiration. So this is transpiration, photosynthesis, conduction of the food, and even mechanical support in some of the plants are nothing but the functions of the leaf. Now let us talk about leaf venation. What is venation here? It's nothing but we say arrangement of veins and veinlets. What is say? Arrangement of veins and veinlets. It's called venation. Now, according to the arrangement of veins and veinlets, we say venation, it is of two types. When you see the different type of leaves into your hand, in different type of leaves, you can see different pattern of arrangement of veins and veinlets. Such type of, when you focus on how veins are arranged, how veinlets are arranged, if you see, basically most commonly you find two types of arrangement or two types of venation. Let us study them. What are they? Very first one we can take, reticulate venation. And the second one is referred as parallel venation. Okay, so what are the two types of venations we find? Reticulate venation and parallel venation. What is reticulate venation? Network arrangement of veins and veinlets. Network arrangement of veins and veinlets is called reticulate venation. What's the meaning of this? For example, if you look at the leaf, is like this. Okay, so we have discussed the center one, it's called midrib. Now here vein is there. This is called veins, what I'm drawing. So this is called vein. Right. Now you see the arrangement of veinlets. Veinlets are coming like this, transporting food and water. What about from here? even from here winglets are coming like this. So winglets are coming like this, and from here also winglets are coming. So what do they do here? They form a network of interconnected winglets. What do they form? They all join together and form the network. So for example, this is a vein, and here winglets are coming, here also winglets are coming. All winglets, they join together, they interlink together, they coordinate together, and together they involved in conduction of food and water. The network of arrangement of veins and winglets, it's called reticulate venation. Now in this case, what is a very very important point here? Reticulate venation is characteristic feature of, remember, very important, characteristic feature of dicots. Very very important. Reticulate venation is characteristic feature of dicots. In dicots, or you say dicotyledons, in case of dicots or dicotyledons, most commonly you find what is called reticulate venation. Similarly, let us come to parallel venation. What is parallel venation? See here, veins are arranged parallel to midrib. Veins are arranged parallel to midrib. Veins are arranged parallel to midrib. And the most important point here, in this case, veinlets are absent. Veinlets are absent. Only you find veins and you find what is called midrib. Veins are present, midrib is also present, but veinlets are absent. Very very important. Veinlets are totally absent. The smaller ones which involved in distribution are totally absent. Now this parallel venation you find in case of, another important point, parallel venation, I'm talking about parallel venation. Parallel venation is characteristic feature of monocots, or you say monocotyledons. Characteristic feature of monocots, or we say, so here parallel venation is characteristic feature of monocots. So here we find monocots, or we find what are called as monocotyledons. Very important points in parallel venation, try to understand. Veins are arranged parallel to midrib, and veinlets are totally absent, and parallel venation is a characteristic feature of monocots or monocotyledons. What's the meaning of this? So here you can take, this is the midrib. Okay, this is the midrib, and all leaves are parallel to the midrib. Okay, so in this case you find this is a midrib, or you call this is a midvein. This is a midrib, or we call midvein. But what are present here? Veins are there. Here what are present? Veins are there. Arrangement of veins is parallel to the midrib. Arrangement of veins is parallel to the midrib. Such type of arrangement is called parallel venation. It's characteristic feature of what? Monocots or monocotyledons. What are monocots here? You can take example. You find very commonly in case of grasses. You can find very commonly in case of grasses. So I repeat again, let us take here leaf venation. Now if you take the leaf venation, here you can find arrangement of veins and veinlets is called venation. It is of two types. What are they? Reticulate venation and parallel venation. Now if you take here, what is reticulate venation? Network arrangement of veins and veinlets is called reticulate venation. Network arrangement of veins and veinlets is called reticulate venation. If you take the, this is a characteristic feature of dicots. Most commonly, most of the dicots, they exhibit reticulate venation. This is very, very important. Example is dicot leaves, dicotyledons. Now, if you take, this is a midrib and this is a veins, thicker ones are veins, and veins contain what are called veinlets. These are veinlets. So, if you look at how veinlets are arranged, the veinlets, they form network here. They all join, interlink together, they form network. Network arrangement of veins and veinlets is called reticulate venation. Example, dicots. Similarly, parallel venation, veins are arranged parallel to the midrib. This is a midrib and veins are arranged parallel to this. All veins run parallel to the midrib. And here, most important thing is, veinlets are absent. Characteristic feature of monocots, monocotyledons, where do you find in case of, you find in case of grasses. So, this is nothing but reticulate venation and parallel venation. Now, let us see in case of leaves. Right. So, what you can see in this case is here. So, in this case you can see the leaf, I am showing it here. This is nothing but center one is called midrib. The blue colored one what I am drawing here, this is called midrib. Now, midrib surrounding to this, you can see these are called as veins. Here these are called as veins. Right. And here you can see network of arrangement. Generally what you can do is you can take any dicot leaf. So here I am keeping this. So here the center one, darker one, blue color one, it's called midrib. And here you find veins are like this. I hope you can see blue color marks here. You can see the blue color marks here. These are called veins. Okay, so the blue colored marks are called veins, and you can see the arrangement of veinlets like this. So generally if you take any dicot leaf, you can see very clearly what you find here is called reticulate venation. Simply what you can do, you take any bigger leaf, observe carefully backside you can see thicker one, green, light green one, very thick one, it's called midrib. Right, and here you can see what are called veins and veinlets. Reticulate venation is very commonly seen if you take any big leaf. That is, example is what? Dicots. Similarly, see in case of grasses, monocot. This is a member of monocot. So you can see, that's why you can see what, so far what you discussed in case of monocots, what type of root system? Fibrous root system. Look at here, there is a fibrous root system is there here. All roots are like bunch of roots coming. That's a characteristic feature of monocot. If you take any monocot and if you observe any leaf so carefully, here it may be visible or may not be visible, but guys, what you can do is if you go to the wherever you find a grass, simply you take uproot the grass and see in the center you find one midrib, in the center you find one midrib, and parallel to this midrib you find so many veins. So any leaf of grass you take and observe carefully, so center, I think you can see backside one line, that is nothing but midrib. Any grass you take and see that all you can see is parallel lines. So monocot. So here why I am showing you this, because especially grasses, very important point. Monocots means most of them are grasses. Not only grasses, you know, rice, wheat, jowar, bajra, sorghum, this all will come under monocots. So in any monocot if you see parallel venation, it's a very important point. Parallel venation is a characteristic feature of monocots. That's important. Any monocot you see, you can find parallel venation. Here it may not be visible, but take any grass, observe, you can see what is called parallel venation. What is the point you need to stress here? You need to remember here. Parallel venation is characteristic feature of monocot. Similarly, network veneer, reticulate venation is a characteristic feature of dicot. These two points are very, very important. Now look at here, this particular part, if you look at, see, the here is complete leaf formation. It occurs from the bud, axillary bud. Here it's called leaf base. Here you can see two small leaf like structures called stipule. This is a stalk called petiole. Petiole has margin. This is called leaf margin, right? This is called leaf surface. Leaf surface has midrib, veins and veinlets. Backside, if you look at turn and if you can see very clearly, you can see. So this is midrib, veins and veinlets. The stalk itself is called petiole. It's called petiole. Petiole makes the leaf get exposed to the sunlight, leaf lamina, and it makes the fluttering of the leaf. Petiole makes fluttering of the leaf and causes cooling of leaf temperature surrounding the leaf. So this is called petiole, and you can see this is dicot, where you can see here five leaves are coming from the, this is a petiole, five leaves are coming here. So 10 types of leaves, we can discuss the structure, but generally the stalk is very strong because it contains more number of vascular bundles. It conducts food and water. If you simply cut here, if you observe under microscope, you can see clearly xylem and phloem, right? Next, you can write what is called phyllotaxy. Let us talk about the next concept is called as what? Phyllotaxy. What is phyllotaxy? Phyllotaxy is nothing but arrangement of leaves. Arrangement of leaves on stem. Arrangement of leaves on stem. How leaves are arranged on the stem itself is called as what? Phyllotaxy. Now here we can study three types of phyllotaxy. Phyllotaxy is classified into mainly into three categories. What are they? Let us study the first one. It's called alternate phyllotaxy and the second one is referred as opposite phyllotaxy and the third one is referred as whorled phyllotaxy or circled phyllotaxy. Altogether, we have how many categories? We have altogether three categories. What is phyllotaxy? How leaves are arranged on the stem? It's called phyllotaxy. How leaves formation occurs on the stem? Itself is called phyllotaxy. It divided into three types. We say them as alternate phyllotaxy, opposite phyllotaxy, and then whorled phyllotaxy. Now, what is the first one? So the very first one, it's called alternate phyllotaxy. We say that one leaf or single leaf arises from each node. Meaning what? One leaf from one node. Okay. So what is alternate phyllotaxy here? What is alternate phyllotaxy? Single leaf arises from each node. One leaf arises from each node. Meaning what? There is a formation of one leaf from one node. There is a formation of one leaf from one node. So here if you look for example, you can take example. Examples are very, very important. Clearly you can make a note of the examples. Hibiscus, Rosa sinensis. What is this Hibiscus Rosa sinensis? So here this itself is nothing but hibiscus, you know, it's commonly called China rose. It's commonly called as what? China rose. China rose is a common name. Scientific name is Hibiscus Rosa sinensis. Now similarly you can also take other examples like mustard. Mustard is a common name. Scientific name is Brassica. Try to remember scientific name and common names. Hibiscus Rosa sinensis is a scientific name for China rose. Mustard is a common name for Brassica. Brassica is a scientific name. Similarly, sunflower. Sunflower is a common name. Scientific name is Helianthus. Okay, otherwise you can write this here and this here, no problem. Hibiscus Rosa sinensis is called China rose. Brassica is a mustard. Helianthus is a sunflower. All three are examples for alternate phyllotaxy. Now let us see why it is called alternate phyllotaxy. Now for example, if you say that this is a stem on which this is a node. From what we have studied, one leaf arises from one node. From one node you can see only one leaf. So this is a leaf. So here maybe the other one is coming like this. So this is again next leaf like this. Okay, this is one node. On from one node what's coming is only one leaf. Upper one, again one node, what's coming is one leaf. Now if you look at the pattern of arrangement, it will be like this. Alternative to each other. This leaf is alternative to the next leaf. This leaf alternate to the next leaf. This is alternate to the next leaf. That's why it's called alternate phyllotaxy, or itself is also called spiral phyllotaxy. Why? Because it looks like spiral. Why? Because it looks like spiral. From one node, one leaf formation. Another node, another leaf formation. Alternatively, there is a single leaf arises from each node, one leaf from one node, alternatively. So it's called alternate phyllotaxy or spiral phyllotaxy. Where do you find such type of arrangement? Hibiscus, mustard, sunflower. What is the main concept to remember? One leaf arises from one node. Let us come to the second one. What is the second one? Opposite phyllotaxy. What is opposite phyllotaxy? In this case we say a pair of leaves. A pair of leaves arises from each node. Right? A pair of leaf arises from each node. What's the meaning that? Accordingly we say the two leaves arises from one node. So here how many leaves formation occurs? One node gives two leaves. So such type of arrangement you can find in case of examples I'm writing. Calotropis and guava. So examples are very, very important. Where do you find such type of arrangement? Guava and calotropis. What's the meaning of this? Now you can see the plant. So this is one node. Here only one node is present. From one node, how many leaves are coming? This is one leaf, this is another leaf. Similarly, this is another node. One leaf, another leaf. So here, opposite to each other. These leaves are opposite to each other. That's why it's called opposite phyllotaxy. It's called opposite phyllotaxy. What is opposite phyllotaxy here? A pair of leaves arises from each node. One pair. One pair means how many leaves? Two leaves. Two leaves arises from each node. Okay, so where do you find such type of arrangement? Calotropis and guava. In both cases here, one leaf is exactly opposite to other leaf, and from one node you can see formation of two leaves. That's why it's called opposite phyllotaxy. Similarly, let us see whorled or circular phyllotaxy. What's the meaning of whorled here? We say many leaves arises from each node. So let us write down, many leaves arises from each node. So here maybe many leaves, so one node contains many leaves, one node has many leaves. So you find such kind of arrangement. I'm writing examples here. Alstonia and Nerium. What are the examples I wrote? Alstonia and Nerium. So what happens in this case? I'll draw here. So if this is the case, this is one node, this is one node. From one node you can see so many leaves are coming. So from one node you can see so many leaves are coming. It goes like this. This is another node. So from this, so many leaves are coming. Okay, so if this from one node, if you can see many leaves are there, it's called whorled or circled phyllotaxy. Where do you find? You find, you have to remember the names of the plants where you can see such kind of arrangement. You have to remember Alstonia and Nerium. So again I repeat here. So what is phyllotaxy? Phyllotaxy is called arrangement of leaves on the stem. Okay, so what are the three types? Alternate or spiral phyllotaxy. What is the meaning of that? Single leaf arises from each node. That means one leaf from one node. Such kind of arrangement, if you look at here, one node, one leaf comes, another node, another leaf comes, one leaf from one node, and they arise alternatively on spirally. That's why it's called spiral or alternate. Examples you need to remember, practice very thoroughly, write spiral or alternate phyllotaxy, subheading, and practice the examples. Okay, of course concept you have to remember and practice the examples. Hibiscus rosa sinensis, common name is China. Brassica, common name is mustard. Helianthus, common name is sunflower. Similarly, opposite phyllotaxy here, a pair of leaves arises from each node, two leaves from one node. So this is one node, so two leaves formation is happening from one node, and they are both are lying opposite to each other. Here also opposite, that's why they are called opposite phyllotaxy. Where do you find? Remember the names of the plant where you can see such type of leaf arrangement on the stem. Calotropis guava. Right, next, whorled or circled phyllotaxy, many leaves arises from each node. That means one node here, one node contains many leaves. So examples are important for you to remember, Alstonia and Nerium. So very very easy, take all three types and what is the definition along with the examples. Simply you can remember the diagrams itself, it makes the concept very very easy. here I'll give you the table. In the table, let us remember about the scientist. Carolus von Linnaeus, I'm giving you name of the scientist and discovery. Name of the scientist, and we are discussing discovery. Name of the scientist, Carolus von Linnaeus. Who's the name of the scientist we are discussing? Carolus von Linnaeus. What was the discovery as made? Now he is the one who introduced sexual system of classification or artificial system of classification. System of classification. What did he introduce? Here, classification means we are going to classify the plants into different types, and that classification is based upon sexual characters. What are the sexual characters we take? Androecium and gynoecium. Antho and stigma. Stigma, style, ovary. So if you take in a plant, so this is in the plant or in the flower if you take. In the flower, you find this is called antho. Right. And this is called stigma. So here, anther is considered as male and stigma is considered as female. Anther is considered as male, stigma is considered as female. So, anther condition, stigma condition comes under sexual characters. Itself is called artificial system of classification. What did he introduce? Sexual system of classification, or itself is called artificial system of classification. And he introduced the branch called taxonomy. Taxonomy is nothing but, again, study of. It is a branch of science which speaks about classification of plants. Right? What is a branch? Taxonomy. What is taxonomy? It's one of the branch of the life science which deals with the classification of plants. So I say study of classification of plants. He is the first person who studied different type of plants, classified into different type of groups based upon different characters. So he is called father of taxonomy. So whenever we get the question that who is the father of taxonomy means, you have to remember Carolus von Linnaeus. What did he introduce? Sexual or artificial system of classification, and also he has given the branch called taxonomy. Similarly, he has written, he introduced or he popularized binomial nomenclature. He popularized binomial nomenclature. So what is binomial nomenclature? If you remember, Caspar Bohin is a scientist who introduced binomial nomenclature. What is binomial nomenclature? We discussed earlier also. Each plant has one scientific name that contains genus name, species name, two words. Bi means two words. Nomial, two words are there. Nomenclature for naming the plant. It's called binomial nomenclature. We'll come to know about this later. We'll discuss later. It is a concept, it is there in the chapter. So, who popularized means, who has given binomial nomenclature for scientific names means, who is that? Carolus von Linnaeus. But here two types of questions are there. Who introduced binomial nomenclature means, earlier I have given Caspar Bohin. I repeat the question. Who introduced binomial nomenclature means, Caspar Bohin, scientist name Caspar Bohin, as given for last class. Who popularized binomial nomenclature? Popularized means used for number of plants. That is, the scientist is Carolus von Linnaeus. Now, he has written two books. What